Thank you, and thanks to everyone for coming out tonight. It's nice to see so many folks here, and nice to see a number of friendly faces, friends and folks I haven't seen for quite a while. Can I just get, just so I get a sense of who I'm talking to, can I get a show of hands for all the Vietnam veterans in the room? All right, well, let me begin then by saying thank you all for your service. Any other veterans in the room this evening? Or well, and that was gonna be my next question, other widows or family members? Absolutely, absolutely. Yes, sir. Okay, great. Well, again, welcome to y'all. Thanks so much for coming out. We've got about an hour or so tonight. I thought I would talk for in the range of about 30 to 40 minutes. I can talk all night if you let me talk about this, but hoping to have some time for maybe some questions and comments, discussion. I'm sure a lot of you have stories you'd like to share or maybe comments you'd like to make. The book came out last fall, and so I might jump around a little bit. I think a lot of you are pretty familiar with the history of the Vietnam War, so I won't go into maybe as much detail I would with a more general audience, but and there's copies of the books going around, but basically there are three main points that I try to make in the book. Number one is that to really understand both the history and the legacies of Agent Orange, we need to understand it as a story that's global in scope. Here in this country, we tend to think about it primarily, I think, through the lens of the experience of our own veterans and the issues that they've dealt with after the war, which of course is natural. But we need to understand it as a story that's continuing to affect people in Vietnam and throughout Southeast Asia to this day as well. And really that it's much more of a global scope, that there are issues related to the history of Agent Orange that touch people in Australia, New Zealand, Korea, Canada. It really is a global scope. The second point that I try to make in the book is that Agent Orange is fundamentally an interdisciplinary problem. There's only so much that history can tell us about Agent Orange. There's only so much that science can tell us about Agent Orange. And part of the point that I try to make in the book is that there are really limits in both of those areas to what we can eventually know about Agent Orange and about its effects on particular bodies of particular veterans or other victims of Agent Orange throughout the world. And that's a frustrating part of the story for a lot of people, but it's one that I think we need to come to terms with and understand the problem of uncertainty, as I frame it in the book, really more as a political problem than as a scientific or a historical problem. And then finally, the third one, and the one that I'll spend the most time talking about tonight, is that to really understand the history of Agent Orange, we've got to try to understand it in its context, to go back to the world of the late 1950s and the 1960s to try to understand what this stuff was, how it was used, why it was used, and how people understood it at the time. Because the ways in which we think about Agent Orange now, 50 years removed from the end of from the Vietnam War, and the ways in which we understand our relationships between chemicals and the body and the environment are all very different now than they were in the 1950s and 60s. And so we need to try to pretend as historians that we go back into the time frame in which all this was happening and understand it from the point of view of people who experienced it, who made decisions, and who encountered Agent Orange, as some of you, I imagine, in this room did, back in the 1950s and into the 1960s and 1970s. So I'll get to most of those points, but I want to start with just kind of a general background by way of that introduction and go back and try to understand a little bit about how it was that the United States came to use chemicals like Agent Orange in Southeast Asia in the 1960s. So to begin with, want to understand a little bit about how it was the United States came to be entangled in that war, a history, again, with which a lot of you, I'm sure, are familiar. So in the mid-1950s, after the first Indochina War, the war between Vietnam and France was over, the Eisenhower administration was faced with a decision about whether or not to get more entangled in Vietnam and get involved in what was essentially a civil war in that country. Eisenhower repeatedly chose not to send troops, didn't want to get tangled up in what he saw as a potentially really dangerous, long-lasting conflict. But the United States did very actively support what came to be known as the Republic of Vietnam, or what a lot of us know as South Vietnam, and helped essentially create that country out of thin air in 1954. So as part of the Cold War then, suddenly the struggle for Vietnamese independence was now essentially a civil war between a communist North and a non-communist South. And this was the problem then that the Kennedy administration inherited when it took office in 1961. And so the United States supported the government of a man named Ngo Dinh Diem, who was he was a Catholic. He had been educated in the United States. He was a long ally of John F. Kennedy going back to his time in the Senate. And so the United States attempted to basically build this nation called South Vietnam by working with Diem and American advisors, both military and civilian, in that area. But the problem they were facing was a growing communist insurgency in the countryside. And it wasn't completely communist, but it was dominated by communist figures at that time. There were nationalists, there were others involved in that coalition. But throughout the late 50s and especially into the early 1960s, the first years of the Kennedy administration, there was a growing revolution in Vietnam. And the Kennedy administration was trying to grapple with a good solution to combat that problem that differed from the approach to a variety of conflicts that the Eisenhower administration had taken. And so instead of the theory of massive retaliation that guided Eisenhower's foreign policy, where he essentially relied on the nuclear arsenal of the United States and the nuclear arsenal of the Soviet Union to have mutually assured destruction so those countries wouldn't go to war with one another, the Kennedy administration brought in a foreign policy that they called flexible response, that they were determined to meet the challenge of what they saw as a growing world communist revolution throughout the world, particularly in what we called at the time the Third World. And so what they really wanted to do in lieu of going into these massive conflicts like the Korean War, for example, they thought they could come up with more flexible responses, relying on superior technology, superior financial resources, and superior scientific knowledge as a substitute, essentially, for manpower. That they were going to meet the Soviet challenge and the Chinese challenge in the Third World, but they weren't going to meet it head on by sending millions and millions of troops. At least that's what they thought initially. And so the challenge, though, that they found themselves with in this area was that the solutions that they had in mind were not very amenable to the situation in South Vietnam, that these technological solutions weren't a good solution for what was on the ground, a fundamentally political problem. And they kept throwing different kinds of resources at it. They tried to be very creative in their mindset. This was the best and the brightest, and Robert McNamara and all these guys. And they really thought that they could somehow impose their will, impose their superior technology and their superior forces, or resources rather, on South Vietnam. And time after time after time, it doesn't work. So to give you just a couple examples of some of the ways in which this manifests itself, even before the massive escalation of the war under Lyndon Johnson in 1965, the United States was really trying to exert its control over a very unruly, difficult to control environment. A couple examples of how they did this in the early phase. Things called strategic hamlets. Any of the veterans in the room ever work in and around strategic hamlets in Vietnam? These would have been pretty early on in the war. So basically what they would do is prior to World War II, these would have been called concentration camps. They would round up the population from these various villages and put them into a concentrated area, surround them by barbed wire, and the theory was that they could isolate the Vietnamese rural population from what they saw as external forces, communist guerrillas, essentially. And these, like a lot of things, ended up being very counterproductive. It actually made the population easier to infiltrate because so many of the communist guerrillas were coming from the local population. It was an indigenous insurgency. It wasn't being caused by some external force. Another thing they tried to do, Robert McNamara, Secretary of Defense under Kennedy and Johnson, put in what was called the McNamara Line and attempted to put in electronic surveillance to deal with the growing problem of North Vietnamese troops and supplies coming down from the North, from China, into South Vietnam. Didn't have the manpower necessarily to put people there in order to stop those supplies. Bombing wasn't working, other factors weren't working. So they, again, tried to use electronics and technology as a substitute for manpower. And then finally, this is what gets us to Agent Orange, is they tried to use a variety of chemicals in order to essentially substitute for manpower. One of the problems that the United States was facing militarily was that the guerrillas, who knew the terrain, who knew the population, moved in and out of the population, were given shelter by the very dense, thick jungle terrain of South Vietnam. So the best and the brightest in the White House and the Pentagon and the CIA believe that if they could defoliate the forest, if they could just get the leaves off the trees, and if they could just thin out that environment a little bit, the enemy forces would be easier to find and easier to destroy. So again, rather than sending over millions of troops, which would have been required in order to counteract the insurgency at the time, they tried to use these essentially shortcuts of technology, finances, and eventually chemicals. To give you one of my favorite, well, it's not my favorite, but a particularly egregious example of this, several times after the escalation of the war in 1965, the United States essentially tries to militarize forest fire. On several occasions, the U.S. military tries to set large-scale forest fires throughout some of these different areas of Vietnam where they knew that there were major enemy encampments, usually, as you can see, along the Cambodian border. And what they would do is they would come in with chemicals like Agent Orange and try to defoliate the area or dry it out. Then they'd come back later and firebomb it with napalm and other ammunition and try to ignite these large-scale forest fires, the idea being that they could drive the enemy out of the forest and then attack them, but also that they would destroy the forest itself with the idea that they would take away the enemy's source of shelter. So in short, what they were doing in all these examples was trying to control not just the political climate in Vietnam and not just the government of South Vietnam, but they were trying to manipulate and adapt the natural environment itself to make it into a situation that was more amenable to the structure of the U.S. military. We've got to remember that the U.S. military in the early 1960s was designed essentially to fight the Soviets in Western Europe or the Chinese in Mongolia. It was not designed primarily to fight a guerrilla insurgency in the jungle terrain of South Vietnam. So in all these situations, we've got a case of the United States government essentially trying to impose its will on the natural environment as much as the political environment of South Vietnam. But the primary way in which this is done is through what comes to be known as Operation Ranch Hand. And it was originally codenamed Operation Hades. But Operation Ranch Hand was primarily an Air Force operation coordinated closely with the Army that flew herbicide missions across South Vietnam. They began testing in the early 1960s. It officially starts in January of 1962 and continues for the next 9 years into 1971 when President Nixon discontinues the program over growing concerns about the safety of these chemicals both at home and in the theater of operations. So throughout this time span, though, of Operation Ranch Hand, here's what they were doing. They had two types of missions that the Ranch Hand aircraft primarily flew. One was, again, for defoliation, trying to remove the foliage from the trees, go through, spray it, and within a few weeks, the leaves would essentially die and strip off the trees. Relatively effective in manipulating the landscape, but not necessarily militarily effective in the long run. The second mission they had was crop destruction, that they used a variety of chemicals to go through and destroy the crops of local populations with the idea that they could distinguish between enemy crops and civilian crops. And this is where they got into some political and diplomatic difficulty, because if you're talking about an insurgency or a revolution that's primarily rooted in the local population, a rural, agricultural, sustainable farming people, it's very difficult actually to say, well, these crops are civilian crops and these crops over here are Viet Cong or NLF crops. And in fact, the line between the two, of course, was much more fluid than that. So they engaged in a lot of crop destruction as well as defoliation. And keep in mind that one of the stated objectives of the United States in Vietnam was to win what McNamara called the hearts and minds of the Vietnamese people, to try to convince them to cast their lot essentially with the United States. It's a pretty hard thing to do when you're destroying their way of life and their food supply. So over this period, over about 9 or 10 years of Operation Ranch Hand, the United States sprays about 20 million gallons of these different kinds of chemicals, 62% of which was composed of Agent Orange. Agent Orange, which was the code name given to it by the military, actually the military for the most part called it Herbicide Orange. Agent becomes a name that becomes more popular actually after the war. And what Agent Orange was essentially a combination of two herbicides, 2,4-D and 2,4-5-T, which have these much longer scientific names, of course, both of which were commercially available herbicides in the United States at the time, used widely throughout the United States to clear vegetation, to clear along roadsides. It was used by the United States Forest Service, it was used by ranchers out west, all sorts of commercial domestic uses. 245T, as we'll talk about later, we find out, comes to be a known carcinogen. It's contaminated with something called dioxin, which can cause a huge variety of health concerns. 2,4-D, less dangerous initially, although people are continuing to raise concerns about it. Today, to this day, 2,4-D is the active ingredient in Roundup and other commercially available herbicides. So when we talk about the two, 2,4-5-T is the more dangerous of the two, but they were used in combination in a variety of herbicides, only one of which is Agent Orange. It's the most infamous and it was the most widely used, but it was one of what came to be known as the rainbow herbicides. And all these things were named for the band that was placed on the barrels. Agent Orange wasn't orange. It didn't come out of the planes and helicopters orange. It looked like kind of white puffy smoke or steam, as did the rest of these. But there were six of these. There was Agent Orange, Agent White, Agent Pink, Agent Green, Agent Purple, and Agent Blue. All of which, except for Agent Blue, were 2,4-5-T based chemicals. Agent Blue was a drying agent. It was a desiccant, and it was used primarily for crop destruction, unlike most of the others, which were used for defoliation missions. A lot of them, pink, green, and purple in particular, were used in the more experimental phase early on from about 1961 to 1964. Agent Orange is introduced in 1965, right about the same time as the introduction of U.S. ground forces into Vietnam in the spring of that year. So all of this, again, relates back to this idea of them trying to substitute chemicals for technology, for manpower. When the Kennedy administration was experimenting with these chemicals and with other types of counterinsurgency in the early 60s, the Kennedy administration clearly saw this as a substitute for manpower. It wasn't something to be used alongside U.S. forces. It was something to be used in lieu of U.S. forces. But Johnson and his team didn't make that connection, even though a lot of the team was the same team that had been in place under Kennedy. So as President Johnson escalates the war after 1965 with the introduction of ground troops and the escalation of bombing, the rainbow herbicide missions and the use of Agent Orange escalated right along with the war. So it was being sprayed right alongside and in some cases on top of U.S. forces. So here's a map of Vietnam and its surrounding environment. And if you were to guess, and some of you who especially who were there might know the answers to these, but if you were to guess where the most heavily sprayed areas of Vietnam between 1962 and 1971 were, where would you guess they would be? And we'll zoom in a little bit on South Vietnam here. Anybody want to hazard a guess? You can see the DMZ would have been right up here just north of Quang Tri. Here's Hue, here's Da Nang, Saigon, now Ho Chi Minh City down here. Anyone want to hazard a guess? No one wants to guess.
Northwest of Saigon.
Northwest of Saigon. So right up in here near the Cambodian border, up near Tay Ninh. Okay. Any other guesses?
Say west of Chu Lai.
Okay, west of Chu Lai, which is, where's Chu Lai?
North.
A little bit. Yeah. Okay. Right in there. Okay. Mm-hmm. Chu Lai's not actually on the map, but yeah. Okay. So if we look at where the most heavily sprayed areas of Vietnam were during the war, what we'll see is that it corresponds very closely to the exit points for what was known at the time as the Ho Chi Minh Trail, these supply routes that were coming down through the north and had these various jumping off points up near I Corps, near the DMZ, and then down along the Cambodian border through Laos with all these jumping off points. So if we kind of not superimpose but match these up, you'll see the connections here. Here's a reconstruction of the majority of the spray missions that took place under Operation Ranch Hand from 65 to 71. And you can see that it's going exactly into those jumping off areas here. So it's actually not as heavy down here as it might have been. It tended to be concentrated a little bit more along the Cambodian border up through the Central Highlands, but certainly this area near the Parrot's Beak and right near the entrance into Cambodia, where heavy fighting and a lot of NLF encampments along those borders took place. So if we put it all together, you'll see the connection here between those two. Now, let me ask the follow-up question, though, and say, based on all this, where would you assume the most contaminated areas of Vietnam are today? That's what you would think, and that would be a logical conclusion. And that's what, oh, I'm sorry, the answer was the same places, Mike said, where basically the same areas that were sprayed. It does move along with the groundwater, but actually what we found, and this is the assumption that most people were working on throughout this time, that exactly thing, that where the areas were sprayed, that's where it's going to be the most contaminated because it gets into the ground, the water might take it off.
How about where it was stockpiled and where it was distributed from?
That's eventually where we get to, but for decades, for about two decades, people are operating on the assumption, because of our understanding of the chemicals and their interaction with the environment, that these areas were sprayed are going to be the most contaminated. And so operating on these assumptions about sort of the science of all this and how the dioxin molecules work, that was our understanding. And that leads to some really misinformation over the next two decades about the effects on both the US veterans and on civilians and soldiers throughout Vietnam as well. So before we get to that though, let me go back again and think about the context of the 1960s in a slightly different way. We've been talking about the choices that policymakers were making, but the question I always get, especially from students who maybe weren't alive during the war, is again, well, how could the United States do this? How could we do such a thing? How could we spray these chemicals on these poor Vietnamese people? And that's a legitimate question to ask. But again, what we want to try to do is go back and try to understand the world as it was experienced by policymakers, by decision makers, at the time. And some of you were around for this, so please chime in. But if we go back into the world of the late 1950s and the 1960s, we got to remember the role that chemicals played in that society. In the post-World War II world, the chemical industry was a huge engine of growth for the American economy. And this was true for things like plastics. You've all seen The Graduate, I assume, and the plastics is the future, right, Ben? But plastics, herbicides, herbicides were basically invented during and immediately after World War II, and they were called growth regulators. They were invented initially not to destroy plants, but to grow tomatoes the size of Volkswagens with the idea that we could then feed the world. And it was again this idea of control, this mindset of control that scientists, just like McNamara and the Pentagon, could control the environment. That if we could just harness that power and regulate the growth of these plants, we could solve the world's hunger crisis. Now, it was still very much tied up in the idea of the Cold War. It was going to be used to show the ways in which American technology and industry was superior to the communist world. But it was this idea that they could really harness the growth and control not just the plants, but really nature itself. That same technology led to the development of things like Agent Orange. Once they realized that basically what they would do through these herbicides was essentially give the plants cancer. They would cause them to grow so fast, so rapidly, that they would shrivel up and die. That's essentially how these things work. The other question that people are always interested to know about is about who knew what when about the dangers of these chemicals. And people, most people that I talk to assume that both the chemical industry and military and civilian leaders knew about the dangers of Agent Orange early on and were either unconcerned about it or just went ahead with it as the lesser of a series of evils during the war. But in fact, there's almost no evidence whatsoever to this day that American military commanders knew about the dangers of Agent Orange prior to 1967 or 68. And even only then did they start really hearing a lot of questions about the potential safety hazards of this. And this is also in part due to the nature of the chemical industry and the scientists who were working on those things. The ways in which we think about these chemicals today and the risks they pose to human health are very different than the way we talked about those same things in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, when the mantra of Dow and other companies who went on to make these things was better living through chemistry. These kind of chemicals and plastics and herbicides were seen as a tool of growth and a sign of progress, not as some kind of weapon to be used in these ways. So these herbicides were used throughout the United States. Again, they were used commonly along roadsides, on ranches, on domestic agriculture in the United States. They would have been used on the lawns of all the members of the Kennedy administration. The Kennedy administration early on did talk about associated with what they came to be known as herbicidal warfare, but it wasn't about the health and safety of the chemicals themselves or their effects on human health. What they talked about were how it would appear. They were very acutely aware that they were engaged in essentially a war of ideas with the communist world and that the sort of image of the United States spraying and destroying the crops in particular of South Vietnamese peasants wasn't going to look very good. And they were going to be susceptible to charges of things like chemical warfare. But at no time during the very lengthy debates about these things does anybody raise the issue that these things might not be safe. In fact, they say regularly throughout transcripts and phone calls and endless memos, and believe me, I've looked at all of them, that this stuff is unsafe for human health. They're simply not asking those kind of questions because very, very, very few Americans were asking those kind of questions in the 1950s and 60s. The mindset that we have about these things today is very different than that which we had at that time. They did, however, continue to encounter political difficulties associated with these things. This is a snippet of a map just outside of Da Nang Air Force Base, which is one of the main staging areas for Operation Ranchan, along with Binh Hoa, which was just northeast of Saigon. And so as the herbicide missions are escalating after 1965, we see more and more civilians throughout Vietnam encountering these chemicals, not just in rural areas, but in urban areas as well. There are multiple occasions on which these aircraft, these modified cargo planes taking off from Da Nang would experience some kind of problem with the tank system or some kind of problem immediately after takeoff and dump essentially their whole load of herbicide right on an area outside Saigon instead of dispersing it in those very fine, or Da Nang in this case, instead of dispersing it in these very fine mists throughout the countryside. I've also got situations, which I'll get to in a minute, associated with the waste and the residue along these plains. But people are beginning to complain, again, though, not about safety issues. They're worried about the damage that it's causing to their property and their crops. But there are very few civilians in Vietnam who are being repeatedly sometimes exposed to these chemicals who are raising concerns about the effects on human health. It's just not happening on a regular basis, only isolated incidents. And so to get back to this question of what the long-term effects are and what the environmental consequences are, here's where we can take a lesson a little bit from environmental historians. And what environmental historians teach us to do when we want to study these kinds of things, whether it's in Midland, Michigan, or Passaic, New Jersey, or Da Nang, Vietnam, is to follow the molecule, figure out where this stuff goes, retrace the path of these things. And in that case, in the case of Agent Orange, it means follow the barrel. Where were the barrels of Agent Orange made? How were they shipped? How did they arrive in country? How were they treated? How, if at all, were they disposed of at the time? And this is where the story about long-term effects gets a little more interesting. And this is a shot of Da Nang, actually, and you can see the just this wasteland of barrels of Agent Orange and Agent White kind of strewn about the ground all over the base. So, I don't actually have a year on this photo. Given the number of barrels, it's probably 67 or 68. It could be a little bit after. So at these, there are two major storage sites where the majority of herbicides were stored during the war. One was at Da Nang, and one was down at Binh Hoa outside of Saigon. These were the two most, in terms of volume, the largest staging areas for Operation Ranchan. And the barrels, according to policy manuals and how these things were supposed to be done, were supposed to be emptied completely as they loaded them onto the planes and rinsed and repeated and placed on a drying rack and then either sent back to the States or recycled for some other kind of use in Vietnam. But as with so many things during the war, the way that it was written up in the policy manual didn't quite translate into how it was actually carried out on the ground by U.S. veterans or by the ARVN allies who on these bases were often charged with handling the barrels themselves. So instead, they get not disposed of particularly well. And if anybody's ever tried to empty a 55-gallon drum, you know it's really hard to get that last little bit of liquid out of there. And so a lot of these barrels would have a significant amount of herbicide left in them, and instead of being drained and dried and disposed of properly, they were essentially thrown into these heaps, and they would rust and they would erode as barrels would do, especially in a tropical climate, and the herbicides from those barrels would then leak into the ground at these air bases. But even more than that, the barrels themselves could also be really valuable commodities for the local populations. U.S. soldiers and ARVN soldiers would sell these barrels, and people would use them to carry drinking water. They would use them to fill up with diesel fuel for their motorbikes. And so we had a couple situations, both in Da Nang and Saigon, where all of a sudden in the middle of the city, these trees were losing their leaves, and people were trying to figure out, what was going on because it was pretty spotty. They hadn't been sprayed directly. They couldn't figure out what it was until they determined that some of the barrels being sold to the local civilian population still had Agent Orange or other herbicides in them. That was then being mixed essentially with the diesel fuel, and was being enough of it was being emitted from the motorbikes and the other vehicles that it was causing defoliation in the city. So there's a lot of unintended consequences of this barrel usage that begins to show up. So again, you see some isolated concerns about health. A couple people report sickness or illness. You do begin to see some stories of birth defects in and around Saigon, but they're never really a huge number and they're very difficult to substantiate. So most of the concerns from the Vietnamese population were still about property damage. You're destroying my crops, I want some compensation for that. Meanwhile, the barrels at the bases are doing long-term damage that nobody really has any idea about. So again, at this time though, there's absolutely no evidence to this day that military leaders knew about the dangers of Agent Orange. They didn't know 2,4-5-T was a carcinogen, cancer-causing. They didn't know it was a teratogen causing potential birth defects in fetuses. Only about this time in the mid-1960s are scientists in the United States and in Europe making significant advances in their own research to try to connect some of these issues. The chemical companies are a different matter, however, though. There's a lot of evidence in a couple of different archives, and this is talked about in the book, that most of the major chemical manufacturers of Agent Orange knew about the dangers associated with 2,4-5-T. Dow Chemical from Midland, Michigan, in 1965, just prior to the introduction of ground forces into Vietnam, calls essentially a summit. And they call Monsanto and Diamond Alkali and Hercules, and they fly all the major figures from the chemical companies to Midland. They fly into Midland Airport, they play a round of golf at the local country club, and they go into the labs because the scientists at Dow have determined that they have detected a way to limit the dioxin that's present in herbicide 2,4-5-T. That essentially what they say is it's a function of how quickly and at what temperature the chemical reaction is conducted that produces the herbicide. And that if you slow down the process and if you lower the temperature of the operation, you can limit the dioxin that's present in Agent Orange, in 2,4-5-T, to what was at the time considered an acceptable level that would not cause significant problems for human health. And they basically tell their friends from the other chemical companies that everybody should start instituting these policies, otherwise we're all going to get in trouble down the road. But there's no evidence whatsoever that the other chemical companies followed suit and tried to limit that procedure. It would have meant less money because they were producing less herbicide at a time where, because of its use in Vietnam, the demand for herbicides like 2,4-5-T were exploding around the world because it was in such short supply. But it's also not clear that they told anyone at any time in the Pentagon or the White House about what they knew about the dangers of these chemicals. Only in the later 1960s, really 67, 68, do scientists in the United States and Europe and some other places around the world begin to publish a series of articles documenting the effects of dioxin that's in Agent Orange on animals in particular. They're testing on rats and other mammals in the laboratory, showing it to be a carcinogen. It clearly causes cancer in rats, causes birth defects among female animals that are exposed to it in the laboratory, but not necessarily being passed through male recipients in there. So again though, and here what you've got here is just a diagram of the molecule of this particular form of dioxin. There's lots of different kinds of dioxin out there. The dioxin that's in Agent Orange in 2,4-5-T is called 2,3,7,8 tetrachlorodibenzo-p-dioxin, or TCDD, and it happens to be the most carcinogenic form of dioxin that's out there. So again, let's try to understand the larger context in which all this is occurring though. So in 1962, Operation Ranch Hand begins in earnest. That's when we really see the growth in the flights and the herbicide missions. In that same year, Rachel Carson's Silent Spring book is published in the United States, the book that essentially kickstarts the modern environmental movement in the United States. Some of you who were around at that time remember, you know, DDT being sprayed down the streets, these big trucks driving down. Better living through chemistry, right? Chemicals were a huge part of everyday life in the 1950s and 60s. only later in the 1960s, in large part due to Rachel Carson really expanding that conversation, did people begin to think fundamentally different about things like herbicides and pesticides. Now, fast forward to the time in which Operation Ranch Hand is winding down in Vietnam. April 1970 is when the U.S. bans domestic uses of 2,4-5-T against the strong objections of Dow and other chemical companies, and eventually this goes on for a while before the chemical companies stop making it. It's also the year of the first Earth Day celebration in the United States. So within the span of Operation Ranch Hand itself, the environmental movement as we know it explodes during that time. From not really thinking too critically about herbicides and pesticides to having an Earth Day celebration. And this is what is difficult to understand sometimes about the history and legacies of Agent Orange, is that the same lifespan, essentially, of Agent Orange from 62 to 71 is the same period of the environmental movement itself, when our understanding of chemicals in the body and the environment undergoes a really profound change. That same year, the Environmental Protection Agency in the United States is created. So the state is becoming more actively in regulating chemicals. So it's really not until after the war when you begin to see these widespread concerns about health related to the herbicides coming into public view. Very few veterans in 64, 65, 66 are coming home and talking about herbicides. But by the time we get to the early 1970s, more and more American veterans are coming home and talking about their experience with these chemicals. Even after some of the spray missions have gone away, even after Operation Ranch Hand has ended, there are still pesticide missions going on, and so some veterans who were exposed probably to pesticides assumed they were exposed to Agent Orange, or just as likely were just as concerned about the pesticides and chemicals because of the changing nature of those conversations in the United States. All right, so it's almost 10 after. I'm going to try to wrap up here. I'll skip over a little bit so that there's plenty of time for questions and comments and other issues. So why don't I skip over some of this? Because there's some interesting stories about these operations to dispose of Agent Orange after the war. And I'm happy to come back and talk, but I want to make sure there's lots of time for discussion. The point of, again, following the molecule and following the barrels is that when we do that, we realize not just what the long-term implications are for Vietnam in terms of the contamination that occurs at these storage sites, at these military bases, but that if we think about the ways in which these herbicides were produced, stored, tested, it's really, again, kind of a global story. So investigations that the Pentagon has been essentially forced to do because of health concerns related to American veterans, been a lot more documentation about these herbicides and where they were used outside of Vietnam. And they've identified at least 40 distinct sites of what they self-describe as significant levels of military testing of herbicides containing 2,4-5-T between 1945 and 1979. So early kind of experimental stuff during the 1940s and 50s through the 1970s. And most of these are actually within the domestic United States itself. They're not just at overseas bases, but they are in places like New Zealand. We'll see a map in just a second. They're just as likely to be out in the western United States. So when you begin to look at this on a map, you begin to see, when you combine that with the history of the wars themselves, there are very few areas throughout the globe that haven't been touched in a significant way by dioxin. Some of the most recent investigations related to this have focused on areas like Camp Carroll, which is a major base in South Korea where veterans have been stationed and where for a long time the military has denied that Agent Orange was used. And even though there hasn't been definitive proof that Agent Orange was used or stored at Camp Carroll, they have discovered a huge range of other chemicals, many of which are frankly more dangerous to your immediate health than Agent Orange if you're exposed to them repeatedly at these bases. And I think that's one of the other important lessons here, is that we focus so much on Agent Orange and whether it was used here or there, and we sometimes ignore at our own peril the other chemical legacies that can be left behind at U.S. military bases, both at home and abroad. So South Korea has been one, Okinawa has been another major site where there's a lot of debate about how much Agent Orange may or may not have been there, when in fact part of the story is the toxic waste that's left behind regardless of Agent Orange. So here's just a couple quick maps to give you a sense of this. So I don't know how clear this might be in the back, but if you look at the legend, so these kind of grayish circles are areas with known dioxin contamination, significant levels of dioxin contamination. So everywhere from Pine Bluff, Arkansas, Times Beach, Missouri, which there's a big section on in the book, right up here in Midland, Michigan. Places where either Agent Orange or other herbicides using 2,4-5-T were regularly used and tested throughout the United States, all these white spots everywhere from New Brunswick, Canada, down here to southern Texas. And then, hi guys. And then also, again, agents other than Agent Orange or 2,4-5-T, thinking about the broader implications of some of these chemical contaminations. And if we think about it in a global scope, you can see, again, most of them are focused within the United States. There's areas out in Hawaii, in India, in places like Thailand, where a lot of testing when storage was done during the Vietnam War, Johnston Island out here in the Pacific, New Plymouth, New Zealand, Australia. I mean, again, it really is a global story. And all these communities since Vietnam War and since the revelations about the potential health effects of Agent Orange and 2,4-5-T have struggled in the same way that American veterans have struggled here to try to convince the state and battle with the state about proving that a particular health condition may or may not have been caused by exposure to these chemicals.
So much contamination in Florida.
Down here, the biggest site in Florida is a place called Eglin Air Force Base. Anybody familiar with it? Yeah, huge site of testing repeatedly for herbicides. In fact, most of the testing that went into the ranch hand, the kind of spray mechanisms that were loaded into the back of the ranch hand aircraft. We'll go back to Florida. You know, frankly, I don't know about all these white ones up here, but there were several military bases. Eglin was the most notable. They also had other test areas that were off base where they would have longer range missions to test the long-term spray. But most of the testing that went into the spray mechanisms and the nozzles where they would repeatedly spray the same areas of land were in the state of Florida. So that's primarily, my guess is that's the primary reason that there's so many of them. Okay.
Because it wasn't clear to me listening to the explanation, the source of those points of contamination in this country.
Mm-hmm.
And if I heard you correctly, what I thought you said was those areas aren't storage and testing.
Well, it's a combination. And some of these, and Times Beach is a really interesting example because primarily what that is that's a site of production in the same way that Passaic, New Jersey is. Private production, yep. So there's the story in Times Beach that we tell in the book was there was a chemical company that had been producing 2,4-5-T in the very early 1960s and had not been, again, this is before the EPA, this is before regulation of a lot of these industries, and had these reactors that had this thick edge of 2,4-5-T waste heavily, heavily contaminated with dioxin in the bottom of its reactors that they never cleaned, never disposed of properly, far more concentrated than anything that was ever sprayed in Vietnam. Years later, another plant bought it and started producing other kinds of oils and stuff that was related more to pharmaceuticals and makeup and things. But a waste oil hauler in that area retrieved a lot of the waste eventually from the plant and sprayed it on as a dust suppressant on horse stables and all sorts of areas in the area around Times Beach in the late 70s and caused all sorts of major health problems. Horses started dying, young kids started getting sick, rashes of birth defects and things. So that's more related to production.
Mm-hmm.
When did it? Well, some people would argue that it hasn't stopped, and that in fact it's still going on today. Today, Times Beach is deserted. It's a state park. It's the Route 66 state park, and the government in the early 1980s bought out. The federal government bought out the Times of Times Beach because they couldn't determine the level of risk to people in that area. So they eventually bought them all out. So it's a combination of things. Some of them are production sites. Some of them are testing sites, like at Eglin, where the same swath of land was sprayed repeatedly. You know, if you spray one swath of land once, it's not going to cause a lot of problems, but the same area repeatedly. But a lot of them in Eglin is compounded because of this, where areas like in Vietnam where it was stored. Yeah.
Of course, the Mid-Low Michigan site in 11.
Yeah, that's Dow. Yeah, that's Dow. Yeah.
Lysol, it's dioxin. It's where we use it when you're functioning there. That's dioxin. It's just fall rains and mountains. So people are wary that it's all kind of stored air in houses all afternoon. And yet, the question I have today is, 2,4,5 has that accurate or 2,4,5 TDS?
No, 2,4,5-T dioxin are two other things. Dioxin is a chemical contaminant. It's a byproduct, essentially. So it's impossible to make 2,4,5-T without producing a certain amount of dioxin as part of that process. So when Dow figured out that they could limit the amount of dioxin in there by lowering the temperature and slowing down the reaction, they knew they were still producing dioxin, but thought they were producing it at an amount that was safe or acceptable at that time. But it's impossible to make 2,4. So it's a byproduct or it's a contaminant. And again, there's about 70 different kinds of dioxin that exist in nature. Fire, every time there's a fire, it produces a certain level of dioxin, which Dow also discovered in the 60s and then used that as an excuse by saying, well, you know, dioxin's natural. Every time we have a fire, there's dioxin. But incinerators, chemical, anything that burns significant things, chemical incinerator, waste incinerators produce large amounts of dioxin. Another way that this plays in later on is that when you start testing people for levels of dioxin in their blood or in breast milk or in other kinds of body tissues, everybody's got a certain amount of dioxin in them. And if you happen to live in a heavily industrialized area, if you happen to live near one of these plants, you may never have been exposed to, let's say, Agent Orange, but you still may have significant amount of dioxin in your body, and it could still be potentially making you ill. What's that? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. The thing we know about dioxin is that it loves to live in fatty tissues. So it goes in the breast, which then can be passed into breast milk. It's why it's particularly prevalent in animals like ducks and chicken, because it inhabits the fat of those animals in a way that it doesn't necessarily with other animals. Yeah, Hardy? Yep. That was the main reason for Agent Orange. Others, like Agent Blue, were used for crop destruction. Agent Orange was occasionally used for crop destruction, but it wasn't very effective. So that was only in sort of emergency situations.
When we would go into an area and establish a fire base or a base camp or some type, or the Vanilla Airport, they would clear the area with bulldozers, and then immediately a process jungle starting to take back over that space would begin.
Yep.
And the way that we would stop that is using the foliage. At every base camp, every fire support base. So
Now, can I ask, did you do that with helicopters or was that using the spray packs?
Spray and helicopter. But my point is this, every Vietnam veteran, I think it's pretty safe to say, you step foot in Vietnam. And if you're in a
when we come in land, if you've ever seen water wash, all that dust that had been sprayed, all that dirt, was you're breathing that in. It's all over. It's all over your body. And all the troops that are down there eating that dust and living in that are exposed heavily to the defoliant at their little fire support base.
You certainly could be, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
And that's essentially what the VA had in
tonight, but I go into detail in the book. There's a whole battle, obviously, a lot of you are familiar with, in which veterans have to, in the late 70s, convince the government, convince the VA that they were exposed. And the VA initially is not predisposed to give the benefit of the doubt to veterans. They want to test blood, and they want to demonstrate that you were in a particular area that was sprayed directly on a particular day. And A, it's impossible to do that. And B, even if you could, it would be hard to make the medical case in some situations that this particular incidence of exposure was connected to this particular health condition. That's the whole nature of the politics of uncertainty. So eventually what the VA starts to do, though, is reverse its position and say essentially that now, as long as you were in South Vietnam between basically 1960 and 1975, you are presumed to have been exposed. So that if you are a Vietnam veteran today and you have diabetes, which has now been shown to have at least a tangential link potentially to dioxin exposure, you can now get service-related benefits for diabetes.
Along with about 10 other things.
Along with about 10 other things. What's interesting, though, and this is part of what I discuss in the book as well, is that the United States government, the same government that has made that determination, turns around to civilians and soldiers in Vietnam and says, no, there's absolutely no scientific proof to show that these birth defects or this form of diabetes or this form of cancer is linked to dioxin exposure.
And then the LASSO group that's not being read. Mm-hmm. They did a LASSO group, they're coming out so big. You know, you had groundwater batteries that weren't getting it unless you could do a feed on the ground. Mm-hmm. I have a cousin now deceased 10 years back who died of lung cancer. He was a ship's doctor on a battleship that was in two fire supports and the one it was a cruise, you know, Mediterranean cruise, for 1 month. They were in the waters close enough to the gunfire support. Mm-hmm. They're not recognized.
No.
I don't like that.
You don't like that. Okay. Now, I do touch on actually blue water veterans in the book a little bit. And I would say
about them. One is that a number of the claims they have made about exposure strike me as fairly specious claims. Clouds of herbicide descending out over Da Nang Harbor into the... Well, it could be. They have not made the best case. However, at the same time, the case that they have made is not that substantially different from other veterans who were, as you would have told them at the time, in the rear with the gear, who may have been at bases, especially bases that weren't significant storage sites, but who are also presumed to have been exposed to these things, who were not significantly out in the field, were not in country for a long time, who are really no more likely to have been exposed than blue water veterans.
I flew over the area
in the southern Pacific, and I got there towards the end of the war. So I saw areas that had been defoliated years before, and the jungle was already reclaimed in those areas. It wasn't like there was nothing ever going to grow there again.
No.
The jungle came back. But I got to tell you that in all those base camps in the rear area that you're talking about, like my helicopter was in a rear area, and we flew out into the forward areas. The rear area was all sprayed with, I saw it happen, and it was sprayed with those, the guys with the spray and the wire. You wanted to have a clear area out to the maximum effective range of your weapon systems at every base. So all those bases were all sprayed. I don't know if that's in your book, or if anybody told you that, but that's what really happened.
No, absolutely. I mean, there's pictures in the book of the guys with the nozzles working.
Yeah, so every rear area base, I'm trying to jump on that.
No, that's
they
fine.
Were spraying, and those guys breathe that dust in.
Yeah, but I'm also thinking here about desk jobs in embassies.
They would still be walking around outside where it was sprayed.
But again, here, and this is where it gets complicated too, is at a certain level, it still becomes a
policy decision. Because the possibility of exposure does not translate directly into actual exposure.
I think every Vietnam veteran was exposed to the town.
That even
I actually flew into the area you're talking about, the headquarters in London. And that area around the headquarters building was sprayed when they didn't allow some defoliant.
Well, and this is where it gets complicated. There are a number of different kinds of defoliant. They had widely varying ranges of TCDD in them. And what we now know about dioxin as well, even if it was true, and that's essentially where the VA eventually comes to term, and that's by far the best policy decision to make about it, is just to say, let's just assume that everybody was exposed. What it doesn't necessarily, except for the blue water veterans, what it doesn't necessarily trans into, though, is a question of causality. That every Vietnam veteran today who has diabetes doesn't necessarily mean that that is a result of Agent Orange exposure.
Illnesses
or diseases
that are caused by them. But isn't there a link between exposure to these chemicals and type 2 diabetes?
Yes.
There's a very.
I'm trying to think of how to phrase this.
So on all these things. Yes.
But even these decisions have been essentially removed from
practitioner and scientist's hands. Under the Agent Orange Act of 1991, the person who makes the determine about who will get benefits from these is the Veterans Affairs Secretary. And he is the person, or she, but it happens to be he, who makes that determination. There's a whole section in the book about, I'll see if I can find the passage actually, because when the determination is made, if you actually go into the VA's publications on this and see what they actually say about diabetes, the language is absolutely remarkable, the sort of linguistic gymnastics that they go to try to discuss whether or not there is in fact a link. I'll see if I can find it quickly, if not. Right, well, my point was simply that just because it's been added to the list, it, again, doesn't suggest necessarily that every Vietnam veteran who has diabetes because of Agent Orange exposure. It's correlation rather than causation. That's simply my point.
But the reason it was added was because
of
the statistical connection that was higher than normal.
This is where I would actually, I can't find it right now, but it is in the book. I'll see if I can find it. I'd be happy to email it out later. The point I'd make in the book is actually that it's not necessarily because of that. That the scientists themselves who work on these, many of whom are, I would characterize as very sympathetic to veterans' causes. These are not, you know, anti-military veterans or scientists or anything like that. But the statistical significance is well within the range of statistical error. It's really a political decision and a policy decision at the end of the day, as much as anything else. And this is the point I'm making about the limits of historical knowledge, the limits of scientific knowledge. At the end of the day, it's a political and policy decision, and veterans in this country have very effectively fought for and mobilized for those rights because they recognized it was a political battle more so than a historical or scientific battle. And the question is then to what degree that translates into Vietnam and other places. There have been a couple other hands, Mike, and then Karen in the back.
Does the book touch on what the effects of these herbicides have had and continue to have on the people of Vietnam?
Yes, absolutely. And it's these areas, I think that's actually the resolution. I have just a quick slide you can go through it.
There's been a number of really good studies that have documented this. Once they figured out what came to be known as the hotspot thesis, that the areas of concern in Vietnam were not areas that were repeatedly sprayed. It was these areas that in which the herbicides were stored. So the dioxin levels in the area around Da Nang, around Binh Hoa, a couple of other special forces areas up in the, Central Highlands, were showing huge amounts of dioxin still in the blood levels. And they figured out what had happened, basically, is that the dioxin from the herbicide had leaked into the groundwater and leaked into the soil. It's really more so the soil than the water. Dioxin is not water soluble, or Agent Orange is not water soluble. It doesn't sort of intermingle with the water. The water can carry it and move it around, but it's not water soluble. But it gets into the dirt and the soil. Bugs and other animals eat the soil and other things. Fish eat the bugs, and it gets into the food supply. So the dioxin problems around these bases are really a problem of this actually entering the food chain because of the contamination left behind from this. Now the good news is that this is a fundamentally solvable problem. We know how to go in, excavate the soil, and you basically incinerate it, and you can remove the dioxin in that way. That's what they did in Times Beach. They got all the contaminated soil, put it into a huge industrial incinerator, and burned it. Bad news is it's not cheap to do that. And when the United States is not in the habit of admitting that this is actually their fault or its problem, it's been reluctant to pay for it. Just this year, however, Da Nang became the first...
The library will be closing in 30 minutes.
All right, we're going to have to talk fast. Now, does anybody need a library card? Now's the time. So just this year, however, the United States did make its first major contribution, $3 million, eventually supposed to be $10 million by the end of the year, committed to environmental remediation at the base in Da Nang. But Da Nang is only one of potentially maybe as many as a dozen dioxin hotspots throughout Vietnam. The big ones are Da Nang, the Alawai Valley up here in the Central Highlands, and then Binh Hoa down here. But there's plenty of potential other sites where there might have been enough significant storage. There could be potential contamination. But a lot of those are going to be logistically difficult. Da Nang is hard enough, but anybody who's been up in the Central Highlands knows that even today, that's some pretty rugged terrain. You don't just plop down an industrial incinerator in Da Nang, let alone up in the Alloy Valley. So the good news, again, as I said, is this is a solvable problem. The health crisis caused by Agent Orange in Vietnam today could be solved within a generation if these sites could be cleaned up.
I heard facts today related to Agent Orange, I guess.
That's the question everyone wants to know. The area of birth defects is by far the most contested area of the science related to Agent Orange. And that there have been a number of studies that, you know, initially were dismissed as, well, that's Vietnamese science and it's, you know, it's not peer reviewed, it's not done by Harvard educated biologists, whatever it might be. But even to this day, they have not been able to show definitively that exposure to 2,4,5-T in women through Agent Orange causes birth defects, with the exception of spina bifida. That's the one. What's that? Well, and spina bifida is through men, so that's right, through women. But spina bifida today is the only birth defect recognized by the VA related to Agent Orange exposure.
And only through the offspring of
the male female. Correct. And so what you see is, and I talk about this in the book as well, orphanages throughout Vietnam, where the assumption is that they are Agent Orange victims. But the reality is, they don't know who these kids are. They don't know where they came from. They don't know who their parents or grandparents, or in some cases, great grandparents were, who might have been exposed to this stuff going back to the late 50s and early 1960s. And I actually argue in the book that the Vietnamese government hasn't done itself any favors by, I think, over-exaggerating the numbers of Agent Orange victims related to birth defects, because there might be other issues, chemicals, nutrition, whatever it might be, in certain areas that are actually causing these things, which again might be solvable problems.
An area of history that has so much passion and fervor behind it, with people who are still alive, who are part of that living history, and so many sort of different facets of it, political, scientific, the interpretive, historic, and the memory aspects of it. As a historian, what's that like to try to parse those different aspects of it? And do you find that exciting? Do you find it exhausting? And where do you think this research is going to be taking you next?
I think it's all those things. I think it's the best thing about it, because I can hear the stories. I mean, one of the best things about working with vets, and there's guys in the room who have come and talked to my classes about Vietnam and talked about their experiences in the war. That's a great part of it. Getting to hear the stories from the people who were actually there is a great part of it, as we've heard tonight. But the challenge of it is the kind of memory issue, and I've had lots of conversations with vets where they're telling me about some particular exposure scenario, you know, about this orange stuff that came out of the plane and was sprayed on them when they were in Vietnam in 1972. I have to say, well, that's not Agent Orange. And they get into this thing, well, I was there, and who are you, you little son of a, you know, kind of a conversation. But the debate and the positives far outweigh the negatives. There's no question about that. I mean, there's no substitute for hearing those stories. As far as where it takes me next, I was telling Mike earlier, I'm working on a new book on the history and legacy of napalm, which is actually a far more disturbing story, I think, than the Agent Orange story. It's less complicated in some ways, but it's far more sort of gruesome and depressing. And there was one over here in this room.
I'm just curious, what inspired you to choose this topic to write about?
I will come out as someone who was born after the end of the war in Vietnam. I was born a few months after the war ended in 1975. And when I came up through high school, so early 1990s, the official AP high school curriculum still stopped with the second bomb on Nagasaki. Never got to learn about the 60s or Vietnam or civil rights or women's rights or anything. And so when I went to college, I basically majored in Vietnam and minored in the 60s and read everything I could, because it was the world I'd grown up in. And if you didn't learn that, the world didn't make any sense. How do you make sense of the 80s without understanding Vietnam? You know, how do you make sense of Bruce Springsteen and Rambo and all these things if you don't know the history? It made no sense. So I went to grad school and started working on my first book about the post-75 period of U.S.-Vietnamese relations, which nobody had really written about. And in doing that book, I started getting into Agent Orange. And it was so complicated and there was so much to it, far more than I initially realized. I said, well, that's too complicated for this. I'm going to have to come back and write a whole nother book about that. So I spent the next 5 or 6 years researching that, and it's still to this day. I mean, every time I give a talk, every time I, you know, I have a Google alert for Agent Orange, and just last night there were a new study that came out that linked it to a more aggressive form of prostate cancer. A study that was published in Cancer, the journal Cancer, just this last week. So it's a story that's still ongoing, which connects back to Karen's question, is that the story doesn't stop. It keeps going to this day. There was this gentleman back there.
Well, the obviously, aside from all of this, is what the average American, your group, your age and above, for all of us, all of the ignorance of our knowledge. Age and above is something people hear. But the actual raping horrors of this, I don't think it's being from the American experience. Because you really, America's the only thing we care about.
Well,
I think
in a broad sense, maybe, but there's also pockets of folks who are passionate about veterans issues, peace activists.
To do this, I mean, you know, veterans in particular who are still active, going back today to work on landmine clearance and environmental concerns. A lot of the orphanages in Vietnam were founded by veterans of the war and by families of veterans. So. I think I take your larger point, which is that, you know, I always say, you know, we're a nation of history buffs who really knows nothing about history at the end of the day. We have very selective pieces of history that we're passionate about. I think the larger point that I would take away from this, and that I think would apply also to things like Iraq and Afghanistan and drone warfare today, is that for the most part, the United States continues to be very isolated from the effects of war on its own soil. And I think that frames the way we think about the effects of American military adventures overseas.
Unless you're a family member of someone who served in Iraq and came home.
Absolutely.
Sure. Or anything of that nature.
Yeah.
Unless you're a family member of someone who served in Vietnam and didn't come home, or came home later and then died.
No, absolutely.
Or, you know, the 25th generation was sitting in the body, and then that person becomes very sick and dies.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a lot of what you're talking about here extends beyond the use of chemical components mm-hmm. in the military. You know, it's the canary in the mine thing. You know, we are, as a country, in my opinion, very careless about how we allow toxins mm-hmm. into the environment.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not talking just about outdoor air. I'm talking about indoor air.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sure. And I know just from my experience in Washington, the older I get, the more sensitive I am.
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, I can walk into the mall, for example, and have to leave in 10 minutes
mm-hmm.
for perfumes that are coming through the HVAC system.
Sure.
And nobody
can. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and, you know, the question I always like to ask is, you know, what will people think back on 50 years from now and say, I can't believe those people back in the early 2000s drank water out of these plastic bottles. What were they thinking? In the same way we look at the DDT truck driving down the street and people dancing and spraying it and guys on the base perimeter spraying each other down with these hoses full of Agent Orange like it was a fire extinguisher. You know, will it be, you know, it could be plastics, it could be water bottles. Hardy? Yeah.
War in this part of the world mm-hmm. conducted on the part of the United States. My notion is the French were there, tried to colonize Vietnam, didn't succeed, were kicked out. Mm-hmm. The communists started to take over Viet Cong. United States sensitive to any expansion by so-called communism,
mm-hmm.
is worried, decides to go into Vietnam. Is that basically the motivation? It's much more complicated. But what was announced as being the reason mm-hmm. for an invasion and the subsequent use of this particular style of warfare?
Yeah. Well, they never really announced.
We're not responsible for this. This was a defect you had before you came into the military.
Yeah.
Although that's, and I think that's changing
that's
but changed. I've watched many a veteran, one special ops guy in particular, who came out of doing both Iraq and Afghanistan in 21 years as in the Navy, who began drinking because of PTSD, because he did not want to acknowledge that he had PTSD, which is also kind of what goes on there. Mm-hmm. And he, when they realized then, when he came into the VA for treatment, 3 years after his retirement from the Navy, they told him that he had alcoholism and this was not PTSD. And there were several years there where they denied a lot of these guys and gals that, but they're now starting to treat. And initially, you could only have PTSD if you were in a designated war zone, like if you were only where they were spraying Agent Orange. So it's kind of a standard DOD kind of response to our soldiers and sailors.
No, absolutely. And another argument I make in the book is that the story of
it's always about much more than Agent Orange. And you can't separate the way in which Agent Orange is sort of constructed socially and culturally in the late 70s and early 80s in particular. You can't separate that from the way in which veterans were treated when they came home. That the treatment that veterans received at that point becomes part of the way that we understand Agent Orange. The lousy healthcare at the VA, the lack of sort of an open embrace and welcome home and this kind of stuff, all that relates to the political nature of Agent Orange and the way in which it all becomes politicized. So you had your hand up earlier. Thanks for coming, by the way.
I want to ask you. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I got the impression that you felt there was a dubious
your attention, please. The library will be closed.
Could you not immediately, as a result of exposure to the
Did
your research show any link to any of these 10 or 12 things that could be in it?
Oh, it does. Yeah,
some of it just the type 2 diabetes one is questionable.
Well, and I'm not, I want to be clear, I'm not a scientist, I'm not a medical practitioner. I've read a lot of the literature and I've tried to understand the basis for the policies.
My reading of this is that there's a very clear link for a lot of those conditions. That's less strong for diabetes. It's less strong for hypertension. Prostate cancer seems to be a little more solid. I haven't read
prostate
anything.
Prostate cancer is top of the list.
What's that?
Prostate cancer, top of the list.
And what I'll just suggest is, again, when you go back and look at the basis on which the VA makes its decisions and the degree of certainty that they claim, it's not as strong as it would suggest. Now, my personal position is that veterans should be given the benefit of the doubt. We shouldn't have to prove, it's not a question of that, healthcare and coverage. But when we start saying that, well, there is a clear scientific link or there's clear historical evidence for, there's a lot less evidence that you would suggest. I mean, again, when I came into this study, I had all these assumptions and I thought I knew exactly what Agent Orange was, exactly what it did. And when you go actually and read the scientific literature itself, that's where the biggest debates are.
It also bumps up against what is common in the general population.
Exactly.
I mean,
exactly.
You know that there's a huge list of just getting older and getting
Diabetes. Well, and any American male knows if you live long enough, you're going to get prostate cancer. I mean, that's just one of the
things. VA's law, we're not going to try to fight that.
Exactly. Exactly.
You were there.
I just want to make this point with respect to
presumptive illnesses from exposure. It's my belief that the only reason this even happened, quote unquote, is because there was a settlement against chemical companies, the Agent Orange Settlement Fund, which was set up to adjudicate all of the thousands of millions of claims that were coming in, so that the VA was able to settle according to the list of presumptives, which continues to grow.
Right.
But had it not been for that, you'd probably still have a bigger argument at the VA level about whether or not this was service connected. I mean, initially it was just chloracne.
That's right. That's right. Right. No, it certainly could be, but it's also, I think, important to distinguish between, I mean, the lawsuit is a major development on that front, but those funds are exhausted very.
That's a separate with the chemical companies, through which, by the way, the chemical companies admitted no guilt or no indication that these were in fact harmful. Yes, but especially over the last 10 years, it has expanded more so than at any other time since the 70s and 80s. I mean, if you had told some of you veterans in 1978, 1979 that all these things would be covered today, I'm sure you would have laughed your friends out of the room at that. So the point again is that that's a result of political battles, political processes, and policy decisions, as much as it is based on scientific or historical evidence. To date, the only successful United States case brought against the chemical manufacturers of Agent Orange or against the government for its role in that was the original veterans class action lawsuit. Every other case by veterans, by Blue Water veterans, by other veterans, by the Vietnamese have been thrown out of court based on a lack of scientific causality demonstrating a clear link between Agent Orange exposure and health concerns.
And then I started reading about it, and oh my gosh, and then I saw that you were giving a presentation. So I knew nothing about it. So this is all news to me, and I was just like, you know, reading about the Vietnamese. I was like, why is everything being dismissed? Why can't they get some due process? And I can't understand.
It's money.
That's not okay.
It's the bottom line is accounting.
What news or something?
It's gross on money, or lack thereof.
One quick thought. The Afghanistan is around many of our foreign areas. We had to defoliate the area, which meant that the people literally starved because they had no food.
Yeah.
And that's been brought up by the UN. And the other question I have is, isn't the UN also delving into and helping Vietnamese?
The UN's not doing much. There's a lot of
really good groups on the ground doing humanitarian work, and if anybody's interested, I can certainly put you in touch with them. I think, you know, there's really no hope of a lawsuit. There's really no hope of a chemical company's ever being held accountable. And the Vietnamese will be the first to tell you, they're not interested in sort of proving their case based on scientific or historical evidence. If you ask them, you know, why should we, you know, why don't you have everybody tested for dioxin levels around these bases? And they'll say, well, with the money that it costs to run that test, we can feed the children in this orphanage for 6 months. So what are you gonna do? So it's really become a humanitarian issue. That's the terms by which they negotiate things with the United States government. That's the basis for NGO support. And that's really where most of the money for the cleanup that is gonna happen is gonna come from. In terms of justice and being held accountable, no. Is there
raising money to clean up Vietnam? Yes, but it's not gonna come through the lawsuit. It's not gonna come from Dow County. I just want to be cautious of the time because I don't want to keep librarians after. So I would say,
if we wanted to read your book, where would we get it?
Right here. If you would like to purchase a copy tonight, you are more than welcome to do so.